Welcome everyone to day number two. For those of you who are coming from workshop group hours, I hope you had a fun morning and we can't wait to hear later what all of the workshops have been working on and come up with. So this afternoon we're gonna have three what I'm sure will be very interesting and stimulating short talks. And then after that, we will be going down to the first floor in the lounge. So immediately when you get off the elevator, you'll be facing it. And there we're gonna have a show and tell session. So there will be posters and video presentations and people sort of from New York City, different organizations and groups displaying some of their work. And we're looking forward to that this afternoon. So if I could have the first speaker come on up.
All right, so since we only have 10 minutes, I'm just gonna jump right in. I'm Amanda Phingbodhipakkiya. I'm a creative director. So I help brands and organizations communicate complex, multifaceted messages by designing websites, motion graphics, print materials, and the campaigns that knit it all together. Interesting, this seems blank. Well, that's not good. In the interest of time, I'll just keep going then. I use the visual medium to do so because our species evolved brains that process images 60,000 times faster than written language. So you see, before design, my first passion was for science. Neuroscience, in fact. I got into neuroscience through dance. So I was a ballerina for many years before I had a terrible skiing accident. So I had a terrible skiing accident that tore everything out of my knee. And after my surgery, I couldn't believe just how much my sense of balance and coordination had changed. So I was devastated, and I studied neuroscience to understand why I couldn't move as gracefully as I used to understand how neurons give rise to movement. So after that, I continued on at Dr. Jakob Stern's lab, studying how brains change in old age. With life expectancies on the rise, the elderly make up more and more of the population. So as individuals and as a society, we need to understand how to age gracefully with our mental faculties intact. Despite this very important mission, our lab had a problem. We couldn't convince people to participate in our work. So we need to recruit a lot of participants for our studies. And while older people saw the value in being our guinea pigs, it was difficult to recruit the healthy, active, young professionals. Even though we pay them for their time, they saw the 6 to 7 hour testing sessions as little more than tedious volunteer work at best. And our recruitment materials really needed help. We would literally mail people letters crammed full of text, no images, and called it our marketing outreach. I tried to take a stab at giving the materials a makeover myself, but I didn't know what I was doing, and it didn't really help. And it turned out, our lab wasn't alone. Nearly every research group at the medical center suffered from this same inability to convey the vital urgency of their work. So I became obsessed with this issue, started taking design classes at night, and eventually got my MFA at Pratt. I realized there was a vast body of knowledge about how ideas are communicated, how feelings are evoked, and how campaigns are run. So stepping outside of the academic setting, I saw how research is hyped and distorted in the media, how anti-vaxxers and climate change deniers misrepresent how science works, and how billion-dollar declines in research funding are forcing labs to shut down promising areas of inquiry. So between 2003 and 2015, the NIH's budget dropped 22%, resulting in an exodus of brilliant scientists leaving research and setting medical progress back for a generation. No wonder, in a 2014 poll by AAAS, 50% of scientists said that now is a bad time for science. So last year, I decided to embark on a project, calling on some of the brilliant neuroscientists and designers I knew. The leading strand, as I call it, is an initiative that uses design to shine a light on breakthroughs happening in science. We pair scientists and designers to co-create experiences that translate research in rigorous and visually compelling ways. So one of our pairs is DJ Bambamuku. He is a postdoc in Catherine Dulock's lab at Harvard, and Vicky Du, an award-winning filmmaker. So DJ is looking at how the brain influences sexual identity and gender. His work focuses on the vomero nasal gland. So it's a gland in the nasal cavity of mice that helps them sense pheromones. He's found that incapacitation of this gland results in a breakdown of sex-specific behaviors. So for example, female mice will start mounting other females and even males. The research suggests that in mice, there's no such thing as a male and female brain. In fact, they share the same neural circuitry, but depend on their sense of smell to direct sexual behavior. So I did test this before, and the video does work, so let's take a look at that.
Volition. How do I decide to generate the movement to pick up this cup and put it to my lips and sip? How does that happen from the brain?
So that's just a short clip, since we have so little time together. But some other projects that we worked on were a continuously learning song that listens to, remembers, and interprets the sounds of its environment. It acts as a musical metaphor for how memory may work in the human brain. Another project was a chat bot that helps you understand how your physical activity influences your mood and your memory. So projects like these are important because understanding science is important. Much of our society's progress was built on a foundation of scientific discovery. So let's encourage the public and private sector to fund crucial basic research to help drive tomorrow's breakthroughs. Let's inspire the next generation of kids to go into STEM fields so that they can take on tomorrow's new challenges and opportunities. But it really does start with understanding. And design can lead the way by helping the world appreciate the people, stories, and ideas behind the important but often inaccessible institution that is science. All right, so that's all I have to say to you, but...
we definitely have to give it up for Amanda. That's very difficult to do.
If anyone has any questions, I'd love to open it up. Yes?
Did you ever solve the design challenge of being able to make a campaign slogan or campaign design that actually inspired people to?
Use the mics for questions? Sorry.
Thank you. Did you ever solve the design challenges that were presented to you when you first began looking into art as a means of kind of bridging the gap between, you know, participation in a study versus not because of simple lack of drive to do it because they're not inspired to?
That's a great question. So I think a lot of the issues that arise come from a lack of empathy on both sides. Most people don't understand how science is done. They don't understand that 99% of experiments don't work. It takes a lot of time. And most scientists are, they talk to themselves, which is a fantastic thing. That's how research is improved and methods are improved and progress moves forward. But that step to communicate all of this complex information to the rest of the world is missing, and that's what the Leading Strand hopes to do, which is why it's kind of a 50-50 partnership between designer and scientist. So in that co-creation, you find some common ground, and you understand, you know, they're both creative endeavors, and we're all connected by our pursuit of understanding the world. It's just everyone approaches it from different ways. Yes.
I'm just curious about your model, like how you are finding designers and scientists, and are you recruiting them, or do they come to you, and how do you kind of do the matchmaking process?
That's a great question. So it's actually a little bit of both. So I put out a general call, and I also reach out to my network. So I know a lot of neuroscientists. But as we go into the second cohort of the leading strand, I'm looking for climate scientists. So if anyone knows any who might want to get involved, please, please reach out. But I think it just comes through meeting people and understanding specific designers who would be great for this type of endeavor. Just because you can make beautiful things doesn't make you right for the leading strand. You have to read papers. You have to enjoy going into the lab and understanding how the research is done, and really getting into the nitty-gritty of it.
So I'm curious, how many pairs or projects, or however you view them, have you worked on?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. So last year in July, we put on an immersive exhibit of five different projects. So five neuroscientists, five designers working on different things. We had an industrial designer, a filmmaker, a motion designer, and let's call him an interactive data visualization guru. And everyone came in and they just played. And in that somatic experience, they were able to understand, oh, okay, so it's not that one neuron fires and my muscle moves. It's actually far more complex than that. So you can actually take a look at all of these collaborations. They're online at theleadingstrand.org. If you just hit neurotransmission, you can see all of them there. And that's also how you can reach out to me and the organization if you'd like to get involved. Anyone else have questions? Yes.
I came in late, I'm sorry, but
no worries.
I'm just looking for contact information, so it's really not a question.
Okay. All right. It's just amanda@theleadingstrand.org. Yes. I don't. I actually no longer do research. I work at Capital One Labs as a design strategist, so I'm trying to reimagine what our relationship is with finances and using design to do that. But I would love to explore that as another cohort for the leading strand.
Hello, everyone. My name is Anya Yermakova, and I'll be talking to you about one very specific instantiation of an art science collaboration, which is a concerto that I composed for charango and orchestra. Charango, you can see Sebastian here, who's the charanguista. He's a small instrument from the Andes region in South America. And the key collaborators here were Sebastian, who's, in addition to being a charango player, is also an astrophysicist at the University of Chile, and Jorge, and the Pudahuel Youth Orchestra, which is a youth orchestra of very talented, for the most part, teenagers in Santiago, Chile. And Jorge is the conductor. Together, they co-founded the Concierto Cielos project, the idea of which is to get these kids to travel up and down the coast of Chile, not only performing the usual repertoire they're performing, but also to get new works commissioned that sort of combine astronomy and music in both a way that's perhaps interesting to their local Mapuche communities, as well as a way that tells the contemporary account of astrophysics, as we understand it anyway. So the goal, as Sebastian and I started talking about this, the difficulty and the challenge was, well, you know, I don't want to make another Big Bang representational piece. There are many of those already done, whether it's in visual art or in music or in moving art. And what is really the underneathness? What is, you know, as an astronomer who works with simulations, with observational data, what do you actually think about? What is your intuition? And it came down to really symmetries. Symmetries are basically conservation laws. Thanks to Emmy Noether, we have a very clear mathematical understanding of what these are. Basically, it's an algebraic version of understanding what conservation of mass, conservation of energy, conservation of momentum, of angular momentum, what that all means. And while the math can get very complicated, the essential idea of a differential equals zero is actually not that hard. And it is very deeply ingrained and embedded in the intuition of a lot of astronomers and physicists, I guess, generally, who use it. And so we thought, well, you know, I don't want to like make kids do math, but how do I get them to comprehend that intuition? And how do I get them to use it and all the other physics that they'll learn in high school, which probably doesn't have that embedded in it? There are many ways in which physics in high school is still taught in a way prior to 1905. I wrote 1904 here because in 1905, Einstein published seminal papers that, you know, have laid groundwork for our understanding of gravity, our understanding of relativity, that for the most part are still ignored in physics textbooks today. And there are other reasons for that probably that I'm not aware of, but my goal is to instill a correct intuition. Again, not correct universally, but correct as we have it today and not to be outdated. So we thought, you know, one of the things that we have to be really, transparent about is that understanding these symmetries has a lot to do with how does change happen, and when we have a new framework, a new reference frame from, you know, whether it's a planet formation or a star formation, but there's some kind of a transformation, we always check it against symmetries. Do the symmetries hold or do they not hold? And that process and the way scientists engage with them is very improvisational. It would be very incorrect to give a representation of it and say, this is how it happens. It's always improvisatory. Whether you're dealing with simulations or with nature, there are certain laws and certain sense of lawfulness, but ultimately it's an improvisation. And so, actually skip ahead a little bit. The score, as a result, has a lot of improvisatory material in it. It has, you know, very quote-unquote normal Western notation in it as well, to not totally scare these kids, but it also has, it borrows from the tradition of graphic scores that has existed and does exist in lots of different traditions, including the Western compositional tradition, but it invites the orchestra to really play with certain variables and to feel these symmetries and to feel these transformations. So I will play a short snippet. In the interest of time, I'm actually going to fast forward to another port. Okay, well, it doesn't want to load that, so I'll come back to it. In the meantime, I'll show you a little bit about the collaborative process. So the interesting thing for me was I'm a historian of science, or at least studying to be one, as well as a musician and a composer. And Sebastian, as I said, is an astrophysicist as well as a charango player. So the collaboration is really trying to find a certain in-betweenness of our
sort of respective disciplines, both of which have some art and some science. So, you know, part of the process for us was in fact working through some of the math. We spent about a month at a retreat where we went through actually even the historical understanding of these symmetry laws and why they're so important, and you know, what are these intuitions that are so difficult to draw out of an astronomer just because they're so deeply ingrained, it's underneath everything they do. And then also a big part of the collaborative process was actually working with the orchestra and asking them, well, like the snippet of music that you heard, that was a part of a beginning portion of the piece where the idea is, you know, you're shifting frames of reference, but there's no symmetry breaking. So for the most part, the idea is to let them listen and be very attentive and improvise based on cues from other parts of the orchestra, but there aren't any like major planet forming events. And then there are other parts of the piece that, if the video loads, I can play, that is supposed to feel like there's improvisation, but it's a different kind of improvisation. It actually, something distinctly new is forming or emerging out of this improvisation. And let's see if that loaded in the meantime. Yes. Okay, it's a shame you couldn't see it, because actually the ending of the work has the words emerging, listen to the emerging silence in it, which is sort of another event, an improvisatory event that actually establishes a different frame of reference. And it's fascinating to see these teenagers who are really new to contemporary music. They play Beethoven for the most part. And to see them engage in this process-based composition extremely attentively. And I guess what I wanted to mention is part of the collaborative process is really getting their feedback on what it feels like and altering parts of the score and adding graphics or taking them away or making this sort of blueprint more specific in certain places where necessary. So in the interest of time, I'll actually just skip to saying that at this stage, what I'm interested in, let's see if it'll play, here it is. Is kind of taking this into making the score animation-based, because a lot of the material that I worked through with the astronomers was using animations. But then, of course, I have to make the score black and white and image-based and not animated. So in a way, I would be really interested to hear your ideas of how to do that in a way that's not technologically extremely complex and that would still be available for something, you know, for these kids to be able to download onto their phones but could be, you know, used as a score as opposed to just an inspiring visual. And that's it. Thank you.
I was just struck while you were describing the different steps of the process that sort of emergence came out in my mind as a framework. And I think of it as science first and then other things. And I actually hadn't thought of jazz or improv as an emergent phenomenon. And then it made me think backwards onto the birth of the universe as an emergent phenomenon. Or, as, you know, like, so it, I've, are you thinking of those feedback loops, and how do you think of them in terms of whatever, how your relationship to your collaborator and also to these young practitioners?
Yeah, absolutely. It's a really good question. Thank you. This was extremely important to both myself and Sebastian in this process to break up sort of a hierarchical relationship that we often see in art science collaborations, where it's the scientist that has the real information and the artist comes in and sort of makes a pretty picture out of it. That's, of course, reductionist, and it's always not always that way. But, you know, for on the science part, a big intention was to actually honestly show that a big part of the scientific process is improvising. And while we have this well-established scientific method that seems very rigorous, if we look back not too far in history, we understand that it's not meant to be rigorous. It's not actually productive if it's rigorous. It has to be improvisatory, and it has to create space for fun. And similarly, the relationship with the orchestra, so the visuals that I showed you, so the one on the right is gravitational lensing, and the one on the left is a supernova, an explosion. And the Sebastian and his group, they work on protoplanetary disks, on disk formations. And the whole point there is that a lot of, you know, we have some simulations, we have some data, but there are a lot of unknown variables. And showing some of these scores to the kids and then, you know, sort of saying, well, like, what do you guys think? And not just doing that for fun. I mean, they do have amazing questions and amazing ideas, and especially when you get them to engage with this mathematical underneathness, if I can use that, they might actually have great suggestions. So to answer your question, the big part of the intention is to break up a hierarchy between art and science, where science tends to be kind of the dominant one, as well as teacher and student, where teacher has all the information and student doesn't. I think in this case, we've already seen many examples where the relationship is actually reverse.
Maybe you could describe the one way of talking about working between disciplines is looking for emergent relationships between parties, which is not a usual way of collaborating, I mean, of working with others. Usually it's set on politics or a hierarchical.
Thank you.
Hi, everyone. So my name is Julia Buntain. I'm the director and editor-in-chief of SciArt Center and Magazine. I'm also a STEAM educator, innovator in residence at Rutgers, and a neuroscience-based artist. So I'm going to talk with you today about cross-disciplinary collaboration across the arts and sciences. Of course, we've already been talking about that today, so some of these might be, you know, unnecessary slides, but it's always good to take a step back and talk about what collaboration is and why we should do it in the first place. So when I talk about art and science, I like to start with this painting. Gauguin asks us the big questions here. Where do we come from? What are we? Where are we going? That's the title of the painting. These are questions that artists and scientists have been asking since the beginning of our time. These are questions about the fundamental nature of what it means to be human, of what it means to be a citizen on our planet Earth. And at their lowest common denominator, artists and scientists share this inquiry into our fundamentals, investigating through their own lenses, with their own methodologies. So a good way to think about the relationship between art and science is to think about them as two sides of the coin of our culture. In many ways, our intellectual and creative achievements as a species fall in the arts and sciences. And I just want to be clear, when I say arts, I mean all of the arts. And when I say sciences, I mean all of the sciences, including technology and mathematics, although a professor of mathematics recently told me she thought math was more of an art. So that's up to you. Math is this wonderful outlier, but is obviously integral to the picture. So both art and science build models of human experience in order to expand human capacity. We paint, sculpt, print, sketch, and mold, and assemble in order to investigate who we are, the depth of our ideas, our past, presents, and futures. And we dig, probe, calculate, measure, and experiment in order to do the same. In talking about science and art, collaboration comes up a lot. It's kind of this natural point in a discussion where people start to talk about, oh, well, maybe we should collaborate. I think it comes up naturally because collaborating is a tangible way that science and art can interact with each other. It's a way for them to be productively interactive, which is a much needed thing in our society today. I think we're all here because we agree on that point. Our world today is really complex. Yeah, this side likes to jump forward on its own. Can't tell you why. Our world's really complex, and we have complex opportunities and problems because of it. So, you know, to name one timely example, we're not trying to figure out how to get into space anymore. We know how to do that. But now what we're thinking is, what kind of society should we found on the first planet that we land on? This is not only a question of the measurable or the quantitative, but it's a question of the qualitative as well. So the idea that art and science need to be an active dialogue has inspired dozens of organizations in the past couple of years alone, never mind the people who paved the way for all of this discussion. And these organizations and publications are pushing forward various aspects of the science-art convergence. These are only a handful. If anyone wants this slide, I'm happy to share it with you, because it's a great collection there. That brings me to SciArt, which is the organization that I run here in New York. It was founded in 2013 as a publication for science-based art, has since expanded into an event series, science-based art shows. Some of you were at our art show last night. Thank you for coming. It was a cold trek to Brooklyn, I know. We also have an art placement program, a membership program, and a residency program. We try and work on the local and global level because there's lots of local activity, but the science, art, technology movement is extremely international, and some of the most active parts are not in the United States, not in New York at all. So I'm going to focus on our residency program because it's most relevant to this group here. Our residency is called The Bridge, and it's an homage to C.P. Snow, who wants there to be a bridge between art and science. It's an annual program, just concluded this past month. The Bridge asks a number of questions. We ask, what does collaboration mean? What does it look like? How does it function? Is it possible to have a two-way collaborative street, or does that even matter? Can art influence science as science influence art? Above all, we're out to dispel the notion that the value of science-art collaboration lies in the end product. Not all collaborations have a tangible, pretty end product you can hold in your hand and take a photo with. These are the cases where the value lies in the process, in the conversations, in the experience of it. So the way our program works, each team that we assemble, and we do between 3 and 5 per round, each team is comprised of an artist and scientist, or people who identify as both, which is a lot of people these days. And they're paired based on fitness. So we take in applications, and people tell us about who they are, what their experience is, et cetera, and we try and find the best fit matches. Together, the team keeps a weekly blog, which is their virtual space to work within, and it also acts as a permanent public archive of the collaborative process. So we're really trying to build this archive of what collaboration can mean in its multitude of variety. Unconstrained by geography, our pairs are open to work together on whatever their synergy creates. We put exactly 0 expectations on them. So in this way, the program is truly an experiment for everyone. From our first year, an art theorist and microbiology professor created an online science and art exhibit about the microbiome called Gut Instinct. This is still on our website. You can view it. This is a kind of snapshot of some of the stuff they included, like an explanation of belly button diversity, which is a fascinating field in its own, to art that is made about the microbiome, pictured below. Dave and Carissa, the two residents, they were subsequently invited to speak at a microbiology conference a few months after their residency. So we're in the process now. Like I said, we just did our second round of residents, and so now we're starting to follow up with old residents and see where their work has brought them, which is really fun to follow. Another group from our first year was an artist and neuroscientist. They did a lot of different things in their collaboration. The artist incorporated some of the neuroscientist's research into her work. The neuroscientist learned how to make art from her own research, and together they created a book called The Trees Inside Our Brain, which is an illustrated guide to the brain and autism research, meant as a kind of public outreach project, and that's available through our website and viewable there too. Dana, the neuroscientist pictured there, she recently won a Passion in Science Award from New England Biolabs based on the work that she did with us. So it's really helping people expand themselves within their own career, which has been really wonderful to watch. Our other pair that year, they were both scientists and both artists, so I really had no idea what they were going to do. But they shared this concern over the way that noise and light pollution affect avian and amphibian populations, so they ended up making art about each other's science research. This past year, one of our pairs, we had two artists who were also trained in science, and together they created a website dedicated to educating the public about water health, which is an extremely timely issue. They also did a kind of compare and contrast water analysis from their own native regions in Philadelphia versus Spain. Another pair, we had a neuroscientist and multimedia artist. I believe Joanna Riku worked with LIGO Project as well, so she was the artist in this pair. They were interested in exploring the role of smell in the microbiome in co-sleeping and attraction relationships. So I believe they're looking for participants if you're interested in doing some art science experimentation. And these are snapshots from, these are all pictures from the blog. From the other pairs still working together this year, we have a pair, an entomologist and artist, making an ant habitat that's audience interactive. Another pair, a visual artist and astrophysicist, they're working on creating a series of mathematical paper models about galaxies and dark matter, so sort of kind of like science art origami. And a third pair, a NASA scientist and dancer, they both have training in geoscience, and they're translating remote sensing data into music and translating that music into dance. So they're kind of going from science to 2D to 3D to art. And their collaborations are ongoing. Our residency program this year is officially over, but has not stopped the pairs from working together. So with 2 years of collaborations, projects, and testimonials, it's kind of clear that if you let collaboration happen naturally, there are certain outcomes you can kind of depend on, which are the first of which is can be a reinvigoration of the artistic practice. The second is that we can use this virtual space. So it's a virtual collaboration residency. We don't give them space, but we give them virtual space. And at first, honestly, I was unsure how that would work. It was kind of this idea that I thought, oh, I think this could be useful, but it comes from the idea that in this increasingly online era, we have to use the internet to our own advantage. You can use the internet in a lot of ways, but I think we can use it in meaningful, conductive work ways. And that seems to be the case. It seems to work for people. Collaboration also inevitably leads to changing or expansion of one's point of view about your own work, about other people's work. It leads to an understanding of the hard work that goes into actually communicating across disciplines. This is something that, you know, we have to get past the jargon. You have to figure out how to do that. And it also leads to realizations about how to communicate science to a non-scientific audience, which is a really important issue in our science illiterate culture. Collaboration also provides the benefits of having a sounding board for your work without fear of your work being stolen or scooped from you, which is a real problem for scientists and artists alike. And lastly, collaboration can engender new ways of thinking by escaping disciplinary silos. So we've found overwhelmingly through running this program that people are eager to collaborate, but they don't necessarily know how. Here are some of the reasons that collaboration is difficult. For this reason, we designed the program and kind of tweak it each year to better facilitate the collaborative process. We act as sort of advisors and try and identify when a collaboration is coming to a halt or is slowing down and help the pair figure out how to get, you know, back on track. Sometimes it's a matter of just learning the right words so that you can talk across the jargon. Sometimes it's a matter of learning how to fit it into your schedule. There's more and more interest in this type of program each year. Other great programs include Leonardo's Scientific Delirium Madness program, which is they invite six artists and six scientists to the desert to get up to science art stuff. Their application's open right now, so if you're interested, you should apply. There's also the Art of Science Learnings program, which if you were here yesterday, you probably heard about, where artist fellows engage non-artists in arts-based learning. And of course, the LIGO Project's Art of Science Residency. So to finish up, it's a simple idea, but important to stress, the potentials of collaboration lie in the collaborators themselves. It's difficult work and is often a side project for professionals who make a living and a career in a more traditional way, like most people do. Collaboration requires a certain open thinking that we're not specifically trained to develop. It requires a certain passion that is usually only inborn, and it requires taking risks, lots of risks, from the very first conversation to the realization of your idea. In his Two Cultures speech, C.P. Snow talks of the potential energy between art and science, and I'll just quote him here. "But at the heart of thought and creation, we are letting some of our best chances go by default. The clashing point of two subjects, two disciplines, two cultures, of two galaxies, so far as that goes, ought to produce creative chances. The chances are there now. So I think it's time we should start taking some chances. Thank you."
Thanks, Julia. Any questions for Julia? And could you use the mic, please?
I was wondering what the process for pairing collaborators is. Do they come to you already paired, or do they just apply separately and then you match people up?
They apply separately, and that's because if you've already found your collaborator, then you don't need me to help you do it. A lot of people are out there wanting to collaborate, but they just need a kind of third party to say, okay, you and you together. So we ask people to... there's a short application. You describe what work you do. You describe what work you might be interested in doing. And I look for some common thread between the two. It's not always obvious. But for example, the geophysicist and dancer, they have this common thread of liking to translate data into art. One of them does it for a living. The other does it as a side project. But I thought that, you know, for that reason, they would work well together, and that turns out to be true. Our applications will open again this summer. The residency runs kind of during the fall and a little bit into the winter.
Yeah. Julia, I have a question. I'm curious if you've thought about or potentially have already sort of looked through the blogs from the Bridge Project and been able to tell if there are any themes that come up about collaboration, or more specifically about collaboration across science and art.
Yeah, I think, you know, it is a self-selecting group that applies to our program. So there are certain things that are always true, which is nice in a way. Like, everyone has a good experience doing it. But that's because they applied knowing that they would want to be in this kind of relationship. An important common theme, which I touched a little bit upon, was that, you know, for the scientist and the pairs, they really learn how to communicate their science better by the end of it, because they're talking to someone who is probably very science literate, just because, again, it's self-selecting, but doesn't have the education or the experience or, you know, the textbook jargon knowledge. And so I think that's been really valuable for them to learn how to just reframe what they're saying in a way that actually makes sense to people, which is nice. In turn, I think there's also been the experience of people realizing, okay, we can make art about science, but it can actually be not just kind of a one-off thing. It ends up impacting people's ways of thinking and careers, and has started some people on new trajectories. So there hasn't been enough time to really follow some of those through. But we've had 8 case studies so far, so we'll see. Thanks.